In this video, we will be giving you all of the dimensions and torque values that you might need when buying or changing chuck jaws on your Haas lathes. And we're gonna be looking at different ways that we might tighten up those chuck jaws and how you can know for sure that your chosen method is safe. Chuck jaws, from big to small, in this Haas Tip of the Day, Toolbox Edition. These are a few of the spindle chucks that are shipping with new Haas lathes today. Just a sampling, really. Now, there are so many chucks available that it might seem confusing when it comes time to buying replacement chuck jaws for your particular Haas lathe. But we've made it simple for you. If you know the diameter of your chuck and whether it is manually or hydraulically actuated, then this chart is gonna give you all of your critical dimensions. And don't worry about taking screenshots of this. We're gonna link to this in the description as bonus content. Some clever mating surfaces and a few socket head cap screws are all that we need to hold our jaws firmly to our Haas chucks, even at higher RPMs and clamping pressures. Our manual chucks use a tongue and groove system, while our hydraulic chucks make use of 60-degree serrations to hold things firmly in place. Now, you might have seen these kinds of serrated teeth on rotary joints before. They're called hearth joints, and we use them all the time here in our photo areas with our C-stands because they just refuse to slip. Most of our hydraulic chucks have a pitch serration of 1.5 millimeter, the distance between each 60-degree serration. Now, until we reach our large 18-inch chucks, where we move up to a 3-millimeter pitch. The groove width on our jaws will vary based on our chuck size. Our screw spacing is just the distance between our socket head cap screws. And if you know your chuck's diameter, then the chart is going to tell us what that spacing should be. The manual chucks that we'll find on our TL tool room lathes make use of American standard tongue and grooves. And we can find the critical dimensions for these jaws on the chart as well, all based on our chuck diameter. And the chart at the bottom of our sheet shows you what diameter chuck you might have on your Haas lathe. If two different diameters are listed, the larger one is optional. Now, to be sure, you need to go out and measure the diameter of your chuck or check your purchase order if you've just ordered a brand new Haas lathe to make sure that you know exactly what diameter you're working with. This last column on our chart covers our torque specifications, how tight we need to make our jaws. Now we're gonna head on over to our SD20Y and we're gonna look at all the specifics of actually changing those jaws, and we're gonna look more deeply on these torque specs. The socket head cap screws that we use to hold our jaws onto our T-nuts can come in two possible classes or grades, either 12.9 or 8.8. The 8.8 are not strong enough. Now, if you have over-tightened these screws, over and over, say by beating on it with a great big hammer, you're gonna wanna replace them. They're just not meant to take that kind of abuse. Now, inch socket head cap screws will often have no markings on them at all because they only come in one strength, which is pretty comparable to a metric class 12.9. Now, these inch cap screws are about 20% stronger than our standard SAE grade 8 bolts. Now, that's one of the reasons why we as machinists like them so much around the shop for our fixtures. These socket head cap screws are strong, stronger than most hex head bolts that we might use. Now, this might just be a little bit of machinist trivia, but I'm not gonna make another video on this, so we're gonna talk about it now, that here in the US, a really good hex head bolt is typically a grade 8, while a cheap bolt is a grade 2. Now, you can tell the difference by looking at the number of lines on the head of the bolt. No lines, grade 2. 3 lines is a grade 5, and 6 lines is a grade 8. In order for our screws to do their job properly, they need to be torqued to the right value. And we know that this is an SD20Y. It's an SD20Y. And looking on our chart, we know that an SD20Y with an 8-inch chuck should have M12 bolts. It should use a 10-millimeter Allen, and we should torque those jaws to 79 foot-pounds, or 107 newton meters. The best way to make sure that we have the correct torque value is just to keep our chuck from spinning and to use a torque wrench. Now, if your lathe is equipped with a spindle brake, we could just use an M14 to turn that brake on, an M15 to turn it off. But I kind of don't like that method. If we're beating on it with a hammer in some way, we're just gonna be adding a lot of stress to the system that we do not need. Now, lots of us might wanna use an M19 spindle orientation to keep the chuck from moving. And while this sounds like a good idea, it's really not. I know everyone does it, and especially on bigger chucks, it's pretty common. But you don't wanna be pushing up against an active spindle. That thing might kick back, and it's just not a good idea. A sure and safe way to tighten those jaws is to hold them with an adjustable wrench and torque them to spec. That's the correct way. That's the way the book tells us to do it. But if that's the right way, why do so many lathe machinists use some different method? I guess we just choose our own way and it works and we've gotten used to it. When I'm changing jaws on a standard 8 or 10 inch chuck, I will clean everything and lightly mount the jaws for a test fit. Our jaws are marked 1, 2, 3 and need to be put in their matching 1, 2, 3 positions on the chuck. Now, whoever cut the jaws originally should have marked the jaws in some way to identify them, either by engraving them 1, 2, 3 or stamping them with numbers or dots. Matching the jaws helps with concentricity. Now I'll lower my chuck pressure way down because I haven't torqued my bolts yet. Load some material and spin the chuck by hand, making sure that the material looks like it's running true and that I haven't skipped a tooth. If we had miscounted teeth when mounting the jaws, you'd see the wobble in your part. So adjust, check again. We will also check the stroke limit lines on our chuck to make sure that we are near the middle of our stroke when clamped. Now this is important if we are near the end of our stroke. We might not be fully clamped on the part, but just bottomed out against the end of the jaw travel instead. Now we also want to make sure that our T-nuts don't extend beyond the body of the chuck as well. This isn't safe. Now if things look good, I'll remove the material and grab my Allen wrench and a dead blow hammer to tighten the bolts. Again, this is not the right way to do it, but it is the way a lot of machinists do it. So we want to cover the topic and kind of show you what to look out for. If you cross spindle center line with your Allen wrench before you hit it with your soft hammer, the chuck won't rotate on us as much. The weight of the chuck on an 8 or 10 inch chuck is all we need to keep things from spinning. So here's the big question. How do we know if we aren't under tightening these screws and they're just about ready to fall out? Or how do we know if we're not over tightening them and just waiting for them to fail on us? And you're gonna have that same question anytime you're tightening the chuck jaws without a torque wrench. So there is a way that we should be able to verify this every once in a while to make sure that things are okay. And we're gonna use a torque wrench and the first movement method. While holding our jaws with an adjustable wrench, we will slowly tighten the screw until we see movement, any rotation of the screw at all. And then we will immediately stop. Now this will give us a really good idea of our current torque value. Now this torque wrench from CDI has a memory needle on it that records our peak torque. And if you don't have a torque wrench that can measure and record peak torque, you can just have a friend keep an eye on the highest torque value while you keep your eye on that screw so you can stop rotating it as soon as you see movement. If you find out that your method has been inconsistent, either too high or too low of a torque value, then you might wanna go back to the torque wrench method, at least until you can get your arm calibrated. The torque values for larger chucks, 12 inch and bigger, are so great that you will definitely need to hold the chuck with a wrench to keep it from spinning. The torque values for larger chucks, 12 inch and bigger, are really high. We're talking hundreds of foot pounds. So you're gonna wanna verify this with a torque wrench, like we talked about, like we showed you. Now I know a lot of people are using different methods and they might use a cheater bar on an Allen. But just realize you need a lot of pressure on these big chucks and you should be verifying how hard you're tightening things with a torque wrench. Now for some more absolutely fantastic information, check out the links in the description. We've got videos on cutting soft jaws and on installing chucks, and we'll also have a link to the bonus content that we talked about in today's video. Well, that is it. Thanks for letting us be a part of your success and for watching this Haas Tip of the Day, Toolbox Edition.